Penguin Random House New Zealand Audio proudly presents The Penguin History of New Zealand, written by Michael King, narrated by Rosemary Ronald, all rights reserved.
Dedication for Lewis King, Spiro Zavos, and Peter Munce, who fed and enlarged an appetite for history. Quotations. Always to islanders, danger is what comes over the sea. Alan Kernow. A nation is bound together not by the past, but by the stories of the past that we tell one another in the present. Ernest Renan. New Zealand's fertile plains were the last that Europeans found before the earth's supply revealed itself as finite. Our relationship with them has been completely unsustainable. We have exploited these islands' richest ecosystems with all the violence that modern science and technology could summon. We must live with the rest of nature or die with the rest of nature. Jeff Park. Preface. New Zealand history sometimes seems extraordinarily compressed and close at hand. From the study in which I write, I look out on Maungarua Wahine and Rua Hiwihiwi, hilltop pā that still bear the imprint of the men and women of Ngāti Hei who fortified them. Over the range behind us is the sandbar where Roger Green discovered an East Polynesian pearl shell lure, the only authenticated artifact that ancestors of the Maori brought with them from their island homelands in the Pacific. Up the inland end of our estuary is a wooden boom built in the days when kauri logs were floated down the valley for collection and transport to sawmills on the Waitemata. Then there are the people. In my student days, I knew Tom Seddon, born in 1884, who in childhood had enjoyed the company of his father's friend, George Grey. So I had shaken the hand of someone who had shaken the hand of Sir George Grey, Governor of New Zealand at the time of the Northern Wars. And Grey had shaken the hand of Hone Heke. Much later I knew Fina Cooper, whose father, Heremia Te Wake, had been born 2 years before the signing of the Treaty of Waitangi. These proximities gave me the feeling, if not quite the reality, that I was but one generation removed from the most momentous events of 19th century New Zealand history, and that made those events seem all the more vivid and close to my own lifetime. Writing this book has confirmed that feeling. A few words are in order, perhaps, to say what The Penguin History of New Zealand is and is not. It is not an encyclopedia that attempts to tell the story of every district and hamlet and to name every famous New Zealander from All Blacks to the first European child born in Waipukurau. A compendium of those proportions is being assembled by the Ministry of Culture and Heritage for transmission alongside the Ministry's online edition of The Dictionary of New Zealand Biography. It was not my intention to duplicate those ventures. Instead, this volume provides an overview for understanding the unfolding of New Zealand history as a whole over the near millennium that the country has been occupied by humankind. In particular, it identifies the myths that have shaped New Zealand cultures and provided them with cohesion and coherence. It examines, too, what happens when those myths are challenged. It reveals how societies are conditioned not so much by events as by group memories of events. And it confirms that the basic needs driving human history are the search for secure places in which to live, eat, shelter, reproduce, and practice cultural or spiritual values. It is currently fashionable to speak of the histories of a country as if there are many versions of national history, which there are, and many ways of approaching such histories, which there are, and as if they were all of equal value and validity, which they are not. This book is unashamedly a history of New Zealand in the sense that its narrative has been conceived by and passed through the mind and sensibility of a single historian, and in the sense that it identifies some explanations, the hows and whys of history, as more plausible than others. The text does, however, draw on a range of sources, Maori and Pakeha, male and female, privileged and unprivileged. And it draws on the work of fellow historians who have preceded me into the field and into print. The most important of those sources and colleagues are named with respect and gratitude in the acknowledgements. One further point needs to be made. While I have relied often on the work of colleagues, this book is not written for other historians. Much of what I say and the manner in which I say it will be familiar terrain for professional peers. Instead, this volume is directed at curious and intelligent general readers, Maori and Pakeha, who are not historians. It focuses on things which such readers in the 21st century ought to know, and perhaps need to know, about the history of their country. Michael King, Coromandel Peninsula. Prehistory. 1. A land without people. In Queen Charlotte Sound on the 17th of January, 1770, Joseph Banks, naturalist on James Cook's first expedition to the South Seas, caught a last vibration of primordial New Zealand, a land where bush grew to the water's edge and trees were filled from ground level to canopy with copious bird and insect life. This morn I was awaked by the singing of the birds ashore from whence we're distant not a quarter of a mile. The numbers of them were certainly very great, who seemed to strain their throats with emulation. Their voices were certainly the most melodious wild music I have ever heard, almost imitating small bells, but with the most tunable silver sound imaginable. For all its exuberance and beauty, one of Banks's successors would write, that dawn chorus was a mere echo of what could have been heard 400 years before, for by 1770 around half of New Zealand's bird species were already extinct. Gone were the great booming calls of the moa, which we know about from their convoluted bony trochees, the screaming, mewing and cawing of a billion seabirds, which even in Banks's day were banished from the main islands, and the unknowable sounds of the native ducks, giant geese, and yard-high flightless rails, native crows, and giant harriers. These creatures were gone, along with the flightless wrens and the giant eagles, because the first human inhabitants had carried with them to New Zealand rats and dogs, and the ability to hunt and to make fire. And further extinctions would be triggered by the very visit that allowed Banks to hear that still impressive remnant of the dawn chorus. Norway rats infested Cook's bark Endeavour and found their way ashore wherever the ship attached itself to land by rope or gangplank. These cunning carnivores, loosed onto a bird population that had evolved without mammalian predators, would initiate another round of carnage that would take further virtuosos out of Banks's avian choir. Pio Pio, Kōkako, Saddleback and others. 32 New Zealand bird species disappeared after the arrival of New Zealand's first human inhabitants. Another 9 would follow as a result of European animal introductions. Had any events preceding human invasion been as catastrophic for the country's flora and fauna? Certainly natural disasters, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, floods, the advance and retreat of ice ages, the rise and fall of parts of the country above and below the sea, all these had taken a toll over geological time and had a crucial bearing on what creatures survived and what characteristics evolved to make their survival more likely. In New Zealand, the dinosaurs had perished 65 million years before, as they had elsewhere on the globe, but the sphenodons or tuatara's, who had been their contemporaries from Jurassic times, persisted in New Zealand but nowhere else, for reasons that remain obscure. At least one environmental cataclysm affected New Zealand shortly before the beginning of human colonisation and may have had a bearing on some of the earliest bird extinctions. The Chinese chronicle Ho Hun Shu recorded that, in the reign of the Emperor Ling Ti, 168 to 189 AD, the sky was for many days as red as blood. This reference is corroborated by a Roman document, the Historia Augusta, which reports that sometime before the Deserters' War, 186 AD, the sky was seen to burst into flame. Another historian of the Roman era, Herodian, lists strange portents seen in the reign of the Emperor Commodus, 180 to 192 AD. Stars remained visible by day and others became elongated, seeming to hang in mid-air. Such celestial displays could be consistent with the after-effects of a massive volcanic eruption. The only eruption known to have occurred on such a scale at about that time is that of the Taupo rhyolitic vent. This explosion, possibly the most powerful and destructive anywhere on Earth in the past 5,000 years, emerged from the crater now known as Lake Taupo in the centre of the North Island of New Zealand. It was almost 10 times as powerful as the better-known Krakatoa eruption in 1883 and is likely to have sent tsunami radiating into the Pacific, overrunning low-lying islands and reaching the mainlands of Asia and America. If the essence of environmental history is, as some claim, the imprint of the natural world on human society, then the Taupo eruption could qualify as the first recorded event of the historical era in which New Zealand made an impact on the wider world. Footnote: it is, of course, by no means certain that the phenomena observed in China and Italy were caused by the Taupo eruption. Scientists are not yet agreed on a date for its occurrence, although, oddly, they do know the month, March, because of berries preserved on trees toppled by the blast. Returning to the text. There was, however, no contemporary knowledge of where the volcanic phenomena originated, nor can we be sure that there were witnesses to the cataclysm in the land of its occurrence, no evidence of occupation, in other words, nor stories based on it. One other piece of evidence relating to this period intrigues by its ambiguity. Carbon dating of the bones of Kiore, the Polynesian rat, suggests that the creature may have become established in New Zealand as long as 2,000 years ago. The contemporary decline of birds, the owl at nightjar, for example, and one species of duck, appears to support the presence of rats at that time. Should these dates be confirmed and the supporting evidence verified, they would support an irrefutable argument in favour of an early Polynesian landing on the coast of New Zealand. The only means of transport available to Kiore was Polynesian vessels. The rat's presence in the country so far ahead of organised human settlement, for which there is as yet no evidence, suggests that a discovering canoe landed in both the North and South Islands around 2,000 years ago and then headed back to island Polynesia, or that the occupants of a canoe remained somewhere in New Zealand at that time but failed, because of low numbers, single gender or lack of adequate resources, to establish a continuing colonising population. A third possibility is that a small founding group abandoned the country or was wiped out because of some unexpected natural disaster, such as the catastrophic effects of the Taupo eruption. The inescapable fact remains, however, that to date no direct evidence has been found of a human occupation of New Zealand, no hearth fires, no tools, no human remains or the remains of creatures butchered by humans earlier than the 13th century AD. And it is in the latter period, when occupation and evidence coincide, making it possible to build narratives, that the human history of the country must begin. Everything that occurred before that, the formation of the land, the evolution of its plants and of its bird, animal and insect inhabitants, falls into the categories of prehistory or natural history. And, thanks to the sciences of geology, paleontology and paleobiology, it is possible to establish the sequence and chronology by which a fragment of the supercontinent of Gondwana became the islands of New Zealand, which humankind began to colonise around 800 years ago. Maori, first human inhabitants of the country, had two mythological stories to account for its existence. In the first, Mother Earth was ripped from the embrace of the Sky Father. Rangi Nui was joined in amorous embrace to Papatuanuku. Within this clasp, the world was in perpetual darkness, and the nakedness of Papatuanuku was covered with vegetation that thrived in moisture. The sons of Rangi and Papa lamented the conditions in which they were forced to live between their parents. Eventually, they resolved to act. Tumatoenga suggested that the parents be killed. Tani Mahuta objected. It would be sufficient, he said, to prize them apart, and let Ranginui stand above and Papatuanuku lie below. All but one son agreed and took turns at trying to effect the separation. None succeeded until Tanimahuta placed his shoulders against the earth and his feet on the sky. Slowly he straightened his body and the parents began to give way. When he had succeeded, the children of Ranginui and Papatuanuku knew light for the first time. And the children of Tanimahuta, the trees, birds and insects of the forest, were able to see and breathe. The earth remained a nurturing mother, but the sky became a stranger to them. The son, who had objected to the separation, Tafirimatea, was angered by the pain to which his parents had been subjected. He followed his father into the sky, and from there begot his own offspring, wind, rains, and storms. These he unleashed on Papatuanuku and the children of Tane, disfiguring the land and uprooting trees and plants. Tanimahuta, meanwhile, went on to shape the first woman out of earth and to breathe life into her. Then he procreated with her and produced a line of men-like gods and godlike men. This story, which Māori shared in broad outline with Polynesians and other parts of the Pacific, answered basic questions about how the earth and the elements came to be and the relationship of humankind to them. It was the starting point of the genealogy that began with the void, led to Ranginui and Papatuanuku, continued through named ancestors and the lines of living believers, and persisted through future descendants. It revealed that the gods, the elements, were born of the earth and the sky, and that humankind was born of the gods, a satisfactory metaphor for the source of life. It was one of a number of cultural strands that provided coherence and cohesion for pre-Pakeha Maori society and exhibited some of the textures of that society's imaginative life. It was complemented by another story, also derived from wider Polynesia, to account for the specific existence of the North Island of New Zealand. Maui Tikitiki Ataranga wanted to go fishing with his older brothers, who refused to take him. So he hid under the bottom boards of the canoe and did not reveal himself until the vessel was far out to sea. The brothers were annoyed by this and wanted to return him to shore, but by this time the land was too far away. So they began to fish, and after a time they filled the canoe with their catch. Now Maui produced his own hook, the barb of which was made from a fragment of his grandmother's jawbone. The brothers refused him bait, so Maui struck his nose and smeared the hook with his own blood. He lowered his line and almost immediately hooked a fish of great magnitude. The only way he could haul it up was by reciting a chant to make heavy weights light. When the enormous fish reached the surface, Maui left the canoe to find a priest who could make an offering to the gods and perform the appropriate ritual. He warned his siblings not to touch the fish until this was done. As soon as he was gone, however, the brothers leapt from the canoe and began to scale the fish and to hack bits off it. The fish raised its fins and writhed in agony. Then the sun rose and made the flesh solid underfoot, its surface rough and mountainous because of the brothers' mutilation. It remained that way, and the name given to it was Te Ika a Maui, the fish of Maui. Both these stories are apt analogies for the tectonic shifts which 80 million years ago prized loose from Gondwana the land that would become New Zealand. The climax of Maui's expedition is a poetic evocation of the upthrusting, downthrusting, volcanism, glaciation and erosion which sculpted New Zealand's modern landforms. The whole process, from the formation of Gondwana until the human occupation of the country, took 680 million years, the age of its oldest rocks. The rest of Gondwana eventually became the continents of Australia, Africa, South America and Antarctica, and the subcontinent of India, all of which would in due course undergo colonisation by mammals and hominids. The fragments that became New Zealand, however, lacked land mammals other than a few species of small bat. Those pieces of land made up an arc of primordial landscape, vegetation and creatures which largely disappeared elsewhere. This arc preserved Gondwana ferns and conifers. It carried at least two species of land dinosaur, theropods and hypsilophodonts, which, like all their kind, became extinct around 65 million years ago, and freshwater crocodiles that may have died out at about the same time. It also carried tuatara, a representative of the rhynchocephalia order of beaked-headed reptiles, which once inhabited Asia, Africa, Europe and North America, but became extinct in those places more than 100 million years ago, along with ratite ancestors that evolved into the flightless kiwi and 11 species of moa, at least three kinds of primitive frog, and the forebears of wetter insects and the worm caterpillar, peripatus. All these latter creatures survived into the era of human settlement, together with other ancient species that crossed the ocean when the gap between what would become New Zealand and Australia was still narrow, as it was until around 60 million years ago. Wattle birds such as huia and kōkako, ancestors of the New Zealand wrens, and bats. What would ensure the uniqueness of New Zealand's landscape, flora and fauna was the fact that the country had been torn loose from Gondwana prior to the evolution of marsupials and other mammals. All its vegetation and animal life continued to evolve in the absence of such predators. And the places that mammals would take in the ecosystems of other countries, all other major land masses apart from Antarctica, would in New Zealand be filled by birds, insects and reptiles. Weta, giant crickets, grew into the largest insects on Earth and hunted like mice. Some of the birds, giant geese and rails, species of duck, the kakapo parrot, some of the wrens, joined the ratites as non-flying ground dwellers. The largest raptor ever known, Harpagornis mori, or Haast's eagle, weighed up to 13 kilograms and developed a wingspan of up to 3 meters. It preyed on giant moa, whose pelvic bones would be punctured by the eagle's enormous talons. Of the moa, one species, Deinornis giganteus, was the tallest bird that ever lived, exceeding ostrich in both size and weight. Others resembled feathered 44-gallon drums atop stumpy legs, their necks ending in absurdly tiny heads. As ancestors of the Maori would discover, birds dominated this largely forested kingdom from coastal bush to inland ranges and across grassy plain and alpine tussock. The whole ecosystem, surrounded by 18,000 kilometres of coastline that hosted fish, shellfish, seabirds and marine mammals, developed over a period of 82 million years into what one 20th century ecologist would call a larder of protein. And that larder was much better stocked for the fact that there was no predator, no thylacine, no bear, no wolf, no large cats to raid it, and of course, no humans. Even as recently as 10,000 years ago, humankind had spread to and over every habitable continent on Earth, including New Zealand's nearest neighbour, Australia. And this occupation and colonisation had major effects on the subsequent evolution of plants, animals and landforms. But not in New Zealand. In New Zealand, as an early geographer put it, a land without people waited for a people without land. Taken literally, such an expression is, of course, anthropomorphic and inherently ridiculous. The land itself has never waited for anybody or anything. It simply is. And life goes on in all its complexity and whatever biosphere evolves, whether or not humanity is present. Indeed, if a land without people could make a choice, it would most likely opt for continuing absence if people were to become the instrument of predation on plants and animals, destruction of habitats, and, in general, the shredding of ecosystems and pitching many of the creatures in them towards extinction. And yet the aphorism has a point. New Zealand was a long time, 680 million years in the making. Its human inhabitants arrived a mere split second ago in geological time. And those who did eventually find a home there did so because many of them had been uprooted and displaced from other parts of the globe. if the country's geological, natural and human history were represented by an hour on a clock face, then the land began to detach itself from Gondwana at 1 second past 12. Its dinosaurs were gone by 12 minutes past. Its cargo of Gondwana birds was being supplemented by avian immigrants from Australia by a quarter past. Volcanic eruptions and uplifts of land were laying the foundations of modern ecosystems by half past. And the ice age that would shape much of the surface landscape of modern New Zealand had begun at less than 2 minutes to and ended at half a second to one. This tiny fraction of time is all that is left for the redistribution of flora and fauna into the configurations that humankind would encounter. And then humanity itself arrives, Maori and European, within the space of 0.03 of a second to 1 o'clock. What those human colonists would find was a land that was ancient but, because of earthquakes and volcanic activity, geologically unstable. It was also ecologically unstable because of shallow soils, high rainfall, and the limited range of species locked into its ecosystems. The fact that these creatures had no inherited defences against human predation or against predation by other species that humankind brought with them made them especially vulnerable. In the case of Maori, those introduced species were rats and dogs, and perhaps pigs and fowl, which may not have survived initial settlement. In the case of Europeans, a far wider range of people, animals, plants and pathogens was carried to the country as part of the process of establishing Neo-Europes. Landscapes altered to remind settlers of their lands of origin and to enable them to generate livelihoods from the kinds of extractive or agricultural activities with which they were familiar. So drastic was the impact of European settlement that one geographer was moved to note that human-sponsored modification of landscapes, which had taken place over 20 centuries in Europe and 4 in North America, had occurred in New Zealand in only 1 century. And an environmental historian, Alfred Crosby, likened the process to giant viruses fastening to the sides of a gigantic bacterium and injecting into it their DNA, usurping its internal processes for their own purposes. Crosby's view implies philosophical and moral questions. Are human beings to be viewed as part of nature and therefore as a legitimate element of any ecosystem to which they choose to attach themselves? Or are they, because of their inherent selfishness, hubristic sense of superiority and unrivaled capacity for manipulation, an inevitably alien and malevolent ingredient in ecosystems that have evolved in their absence? Or is it simply that humankind has failed thus far to exercise its intelligence and technologies to ensure that natural resources are used sustainably and other species not sacrificed unnecessarily to human greed? This history offers no absolute verdict on such moral questions. They will still be there at the end, hanging unanswered over the story that follows. And that story will confirm that history occurs only because humankind has, for hundreds of thousands of years, sought congenial and secure places in which to live, eat, shelter, reproduce, and build cultures. Those cultures have always been influenced most profoundly by human interactions with the environments in which they were located, and by competition among human groups for access to and use of the resources of those environments. These realities point to some of the major themes of New Zealand history. Another set of themes arises from the mythologies that New Zealand societies, Maori and Pakeha, devised to explain and justify their presence in the country and to give meaning and social cohesion to the lives of their peoples. What distinguishes New Zealand's history from that of other human societies is that these themes have been played out in a more intensive manner and at a more accelerated pace than almost anywhere else on Earth. For this reason, their course and consequences have interest and relevance for human history as a whole. Settlement. 2. Seeds of Raiatea. despite a plethora of amateur theories about Melanesian, South American, Egyptian, Phoenician, and Celtic colonization of New Zealand, there is not a shred of evidence that the first human settlers were anything other than Polynesian. Physiological, genetic, linguistic, mythological, artifactual, and botanic evidence blends into a symphony of accord on this conclusion. The only points in doubt are precisely where these people launched their expeditions of colonization, when and where they arrived, and how many of them founded the New Zealand Maori population. The search by such late 19th and early 20th century scholars as Edward Tregear and Stevenson Percy Smith for the origins of the Maori, were they Aryan, were they a lost tribe of Israel, is now recognised as irrelevant. Maori people and culture, as encountered by European navigators in the 17th and 18th centuries, evolved in New Zealand. And the forebears of Maori, the Polynesians, developed their culture in the central South Pacific, most probably on the islands of Tonga, Samoa, Uvea, and Futuna. Antecedents beyond that point are more speculative, though increasingly the subject of scholarly consensus. That consensus now accepts that several hominoid species evolved simultaneously in Africa, diverging from other primates around 5 million years ago. Fossil remains have revealed that one of those species, Homo erectus, reached Asia and Indonesia, the latter in the form of Java man, some 1.8 million years ago. But these human-like creatures travelled no further geographically, though they may have survived until as recently as 50,000 years ago. Less than 100,000 years ago, another group, Homo sapiens, the ancestors of modern humankind, also emerged from Africa. Genetic analysis shows that part of this migration travelled north and east into Central Asia, and then westward into Europe. Another branch took an easterly route along the edge of the Arabian Peninsula, around the perimeter of India, and eventually onto the coast of Southeast Asia and the archipelagos of Malaysia, Indonesia, New Guinea, New Britain, and the Solomon Islands. The section of this population that remained on the edge of the Western Pacific Ocean became the first ancestors of today's Melanesian people. The group who went south were the founding population of the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people of Australia. Their movements were possible because the last ice age had shrunk sea levels and the Indonesian islands were attached to Eurasia in a geographic unit now called Sunda. And New Guinea, Australia and Tasmania were joined in a landmass now referred to as Sahul. The earliest migrants, therefore, both Homo erectus and Homo sapiens, had been able to travel largely on foot, requiring only short island-hopping voyages, probably by raft, to get from Sunda to Sahul. By around 10,000 years ago, the ice age was over and sea levels had risen, isolating the archipelagos of the Philippines, Indonesia and New Guinea, detaching Australia from New Guinea, and Tasmania from the Australian mainland. Movements of populations through the region would then be possible only by people with well-developed maritime technology, and such a people emerged from the mainland of Southeast Asia some 5,000 to 6,000 years ago and pushed out eastwards into the Central Pacific, where no human beings had preceded them. They are known from their language group as Austronesians, and the spread of that language shows that, astonishingly, some travelled as far west as Madagascar. Others went eastwards, along the Malaysian and Indonesian archipelagos, along the coast of New Guinea and the Bismarck Archipelago, first settled by Aboriginal colonists more than 30,000 years earlier, and eventually as far as Easter Island and the coast of South America. These voyages, ranging around more than half the globe at a time when Europeans had not yet ventured beyond the Mediterranean or the coast of their continent, were analogous in daring and accomplishment to the later exploration of space. Indeed, the Pacific Ocean, with its widely spaced islands dotted across a vast surface, was a kind of terrestrial mirror for the galaxy, the Milky Way, which provided Polynesian sailors with stellar markers for celestial navigation. Peter Buck, the great Maori anthropologist, called his forebears Vikings of the Sunrise. He would have done them and Northern Europeans great honour had he referred to the Vikings as Polynesians. Beyond cultural imperatives, what made the prodigious voyages of the Polynesians and their Austronesian ancestors possible was the introduction to Southeast Asia of the sail and the invention of the outrigger to stabilise dugout canoes on ocean voyages. While their predecessors had, for the most part, walked, the Austronesian speakers entered the Pacific and the Indian Oceans as mariners with the technology, the curiosity, and the courage to carry them where no human beings had preceded them. By 4,000 years ago, one section of these people was making distinctly incised lapita pottery on the islands of the Bismarck Archipelago. The subsequent spread of that pottery to New Caledonia, whence came the name Lapita, Santa Cruz, Vanuatu, Fiji, and ultimately to Tonga and Samoa by some 3,000 years ago, has enabled archaeologists to trace the footprints of these ancestral Polynesians. On Tonga and Samoa, a region that has come to be known as West Polynesia, the migrants appear to have paused for the best part of a millennium, developing, refining, and consolidating that set of cultural characteristics we now recognise as Polynesian. They included the form of Austronesian language ancestral to New Zealand Maori, a pantheon of named gods, systems of kinship and rank, pervasive concepts such as mana and tapu, and distinctive shapes for their stone adzes. These people had also brought with them animals and plants, some of them transported from as far away as the Southeast Asian mainland, pigs, dogs, rats, fowls, and cultivated plants such as taro, yam, gourds, bananas, breadfruit, pandanus, sugarcane, and paper mulberry. They may also have carried with them the coconut palm. Many of these things, the impedimenta of intellectual and material culture, would be carried forward in another migration, this time into the islands of East Polynesia, almost 1,000 years after the colonisation of Central Polynesia. There the culture would be modified further, linguistically, conceptually, and artifactually, into forms more directly related to those inherited by New Zealand Maori. And it would be the identical shape in New Zealand and East Polynesia of contemporary artifacts and ornaments in stone and bone, adzes, chisels, fishhooks, harpoon points, pendants, together with a shared mythology that would make explicit the immediate ancestry of the Maori. East Polynesians had one more taonga or cultural treasure which they would bring with them to New Zealand and which would ultimately prove crucial to the survival of their people and the further development of their culture there, the kumara or sweet potato. In contrast to everything else that these migrant people had lugged from island to island, the kumara had not come from the west. It was a vegetable from Central or South America, originating probably in Peru. This uncomfortable fact is susceptible to one of only two possible explanations. Either voyagers from South America carried the vegetable into Polynesia, which was the theory of the Norwegian adventurer Thor Heyerdahl, or Polynesians themselves sailed as far east as continental America and returned with the kumara to island Polynesia. The latter theory is more likely. It is given additional weight by the fact that the coconut seems to have been taken from Southeast Asia to Central America, where it was flourishing in the time of Columbus, and the most likely explanation is that it was carried across the Pacific to the Americas by Polynesians. Apart from the kumara, there is no other unequivocal evidence of South American influence in Polynesia, and no trace of South American genes among Polynesians. But there is evidence that, by the first millennium of the Christian era, Polynesians were making extraordinarily widespread return voyages throughout the Central and South Pacific. For many years, Western scholars argued about whether the Polynesian colonization of the Pacific, a stupendous achievement when one confronts their starting point and the area of ocean enclosed by the triangular boundaries of Hawaii, New Zealand, and Easter Island, was a consequence of deliberate or accidental voyaging. A careful study of available navigation techniques and computer simulations of voyages, allowing for prevailing winds, currents, and weather systems, have led to the inescapable conclusion that Polynesian voyaging was wide-ranging and was deliberate. As they moved eastwards, navigators tacked and searched largely in upwind quadrants, away from their points of departure, in directions from which they could most easily and most safely return downwind. This ensured three outcomes: that they had a means of getting home, whether or not they discovered new islands, that initial voyages were conventionally two-way, and that such voyages of discovery would precede voyages of deliberate colonisation, which would then make for a known and reported destination with appropriate navigational directions. This was the sequence and pattern of voyages that would have preceded the more difficult Polynesian discovery and colonisation of New Zealand. As they sailed, navigators would search for signs of land beyond the visible horizon, the presence of birds feeding offshore or migrating, and in the years preceding the introduction of the Kiori, the numbers of sea-feeding birds would have been immensely larger than in modern times. Cloud formations which attached themselves to as yet unseen atolls, changes in the patterns of ocean currents and swells. These signs, in combination, created what have been called island screens, which greatly enlarged the navigator's potential target areas. Stars at night and the direction of the sun and ocean swells by day enabled navigators to maintain a running fix on their position and to repeat voyages or to pass on sailing directions to subsequent travellers. This combination of techniques permitted the discovery and settlement of the islands of West and East Polynesia and took its practitioners as far east as Easter Island and South America. With such possibilities exhausted, subsequent exploration would have been attempted across the wind, which permitted the discovery of the Hawaiian Islands to the north and, across and downwind, the difficult but by no means impossible 3,000-kilometre journey southwest to New Zealand. Why were such voyages made at all? What drove Polynesian travellers eastwards, then north and southwards, other than the techniques which made such movement possible? We can only speculate. Some pressures would have been environmental: overcrowding, shortages of gardening space, depletion of lagoon resources. Other oral traditions speak of disagreements and warfare among kin, of sons who failed to inherit land or status, even of cannibalism, propelling island settlers into the role of their forebears, that of island migrants. But such circumstances were occasions for leaving home rather than causes. James Belich identified what he called an ethos of expansion, which assured Polynesians that new lands had always been found in the past and therefore would be in the future. Failed migrations told no tales. One can take this concept further. There was clearly something spiritually significant about the movement eastwards. Early burials in Polynesian islands had corpses trussed into a sitting position and facing east. And a proverb carried from island Polynesia to New Zealand may also express part of the reality of that ethos. E korique ingaro, e ruia mai i raiatea. I shall not perish, but as a seed sent forth from raiatea, I shall flourish. There may have been a phase in Polynesian culture in which the urge to discover new lands was strong, even irresistible, as was perhaps the belief in personal and corporate invincibility, strengthened by proven navigation techniques and the development of large, fast and safe outrigger or double canoes under sail. In addition, there was confidence in the interventionary attention of protective deities. Polynesian tradition is replete with stories of individuals and crews saved from disaster by one or other of the gods, and in the power of priests to mediate between such deities and humankind. When the navigator Ru was travelling from Raiatea to Aitutaki, for example, his canoe sailed into a whirlpool which began to suck the vessel and its crew into the depths of the ocean. They were saved by a sacred invocation to Tangaroa. Tangaroa i te titi, Tangaroa i te tata. Whakawatiangia te kare o te moana, whakawatiangia ngā kapua o te rangi, kia tae o ki te whenua, I tomana kohea e au. As Belich observed, magic, prayer and technical skill packaged each other. Evidence from the New Zealand region alone indicates just how confidently and how extensively widespread voyages may have been made. Ivory fishhooks and chert on Enderby Island and the subantarctic Auckland Islands reveal that the Polynesians were there, at the very least visiting, around 1350 AD. Similar carbon dates and fragments of Mare Island obsidian link sites in the Kermadec and Norfolk Island to New Zealand at about the same time. And adzes from the original colonisation of Pitcairn Island show an extraordinarily close affinity to those found in contemporary New Zealand sites. At some point in the past millennium, however, possibly around the 14th or 15th century AD, the era of widespread Polynesian voyaging ceased. This may have occurred because of the change in climate that produced colder, windier weather and rougher seas, or possibly because of a change in cultural priorities. And this literal and metaphorical alteration in direction left colonists on the margins of their cultural and geographical triangle, especially in New Zealand and Easter Island, isolated from other Polynesians. It may also have led to the abandonment of earlier settlements on Pitcairn, Henderson, Norfolk and the Line Islands, which were viable only in an era of regular contact with other food and population sources. By this time, however, the great voyages of exploration had been accomplished and the Polynesians had become the most widely dispersed people on the planet. 3. The Great New Zealand Myth. If popular mythology is to be believed, the discoverer of New Zealand was a Polynesian voyager named Kupe. Oddly, this myth was Pakeha in origin rather than Maori. Maori came to embrace it solely as a result of its widespread publication and dissemination in New Zealand primary schools between the 1910s and the 1970s. One version of the narrative sequence that David Simmons characterised as the Great New Zealand Myth went like this. 950 AD, the Polynesian navigator Kupe discovers New Zealand. Between 950 and 1150 AD, Moriori people arrive in New Zealand. 1150 AD, the voyages of Toi and Whātonga lead to first Māori settlement. 1350 AD, the Great Fleet of seven canoes arrives in New Zealand from Island Polynesia. After the fleet came, fighting ensued between Māori and Moriori. Some Moriori were killed, some intermarried with Māori, and the remnants escaped to the Chatham Islands. The Kupe part of this sequence was told as follows in the Department of Education's School Journal in February 1916. Kupe lived on the island of Tahiti, though his father was a Rarotongan. His canoe was named Matahorua, and, in addition to the crew, it carried Kupe's wife and daughters. The Matahorua was accompanied by another canoe, the Tawirirangi, commanded by a chief named Ngahue. For many days there was no sight of land to gladden their hearts. Weary and worn out by the long voyage, and faced with starvation, they eagerly scanned the unbroken horizon. At last, Kupe's wife, after gazing fixedly over the sea, exclaimed, "He'au! He'au! A cloud! A cloud!" and pointed to a distant white cloud, such as sailors often see enshrouding the land. Cheered by the hope that shone in his wife's eyes, Kupe seized the steering paddle and directed the prow of his canoe towards it. As he drew nearer, it rose higher and higher. Able to read the signs of the sea as they could read the faces of their children, the voyagers now felt almost certain that they had reached their goal. "Aotea! Aotea! The white cloud! The white cloud!" they shouted as they strained at the paddles, forgetful of all their weariness. Then, beneath the fleecy whiteness appeared a dark streak of bush-clad hill and valley, and they knew that before them lay the land they had seen in their dreams, and for which they had braved tempests and faced even death itself. It was as Aotea that New Zealand became known those long centuries ago. Kupe called the North Island Aotearoa, the long white cloud. And today, Europeans who love to keep alive the old names will call New Zealand Aotearoa. It is not difficult to see why the story was embraced with enthusiasm by those very Europeans directly appealed to in the school journal story. It was an inspirational account of the discovery of New Zealand. It gave names, kupe and ngahue, to Polynesian navigators who would otherwise be nameless. In its full elaboration through a series of adventures around the New Zealand coast involving moor, greenstone, and a fight with a giant octopus, the saga gifts New Zealand a founding myth every bit as majestic as the stories that Pākehā settlers carried with them from Europe, Jason and the Argonauts, the labours of Hercules. Its telling was part of a process that fitted Maori tradition into the cultural patterns of late 19th and early 20th century Pākehā New Zealand, which was looking for stories of resonance and nobility to make the human occupation of the country seem more deeply rooted and worthy of pride than it might by virtue of its, at that time, rather thin European heritage. All that is understandable and excusable. And, one might add, that same account became a source of pride for Maori and an antidote to the concurrent and widespread view that Tasman and Cook discovered New Zealand. As myth, then, the kupe story worked well and had much to commend it. The problem that late 20th century scholars had with it, Maori and Pākehā, is that, as told here and as compiled by its progenitor, amateur ethnologist Stevenson Percy Smith, the story had no sound basis in Maori tradition. About half the tribes in New Zealand have kupe stories, but they are by no means congruent and can, in fact, be divided quite distinctly into East and West Coast versions. In areas where he does figure, kupe is a contemporary of the ancestors of the major canoes and located about 21 generations ago or in the 14th century AD. The kupe of authentic mythology was not always associated with the name Aotearoa, and in more than one version of the story, Aotearoa was given as the name of his canoe. The Smith version of the kupe story and its dissemination in the school journal and other literature, and the title of the first widely read general history of New Zealand, William Pember Reeves's The Long White Cloud, 1898, all popularised and entrenched the notion that the Maori name for New Zealand had been and still was Aotearoa. After decades of repetition, Maori themselves came to believe that this was so. And because shared mythology is ultimately more pervasive and more powerful than history, it became so. In fact, in the pre-European era, Maori had no name for the country as a whole. Polynesian ancestors came from motu or islands, and it was to islands that they gave names. The North Island was known to them principally as Te Ika a Maui, the fish of Maui, in recognition of the widely accepted belief that the land had been fished from the depths of the ocean by Maui Tiki Tiki Ataranga. A small number of tribes knew the island as Aotea, though this was also the name given to Great Barrier Island, and as Aotearoa, most commonly translated, as in the kupe story, as Land of the Long White Cloud, but perhaps more properly rendered as Land of the Long Clear Day, or the Long White World. The second Maori king, Tawhiao, from Tainui, called his kingitanga bank Te Pēki o Aotearoa, thus favouring Aotearoa as his preferred name for the North Island. The South Island was known variously as Te Waka a Aoraki, the canoe of Aoraki, the ancestor frozen in stone and ice as the highest peak in the Southern Alps, and as Te Wahi Pounamu, the place of greenstone, and Te Wai Pounamu. Stewart Island to the south was Rakiura. In the Maori world, all these names would persist in simultaneous usage until around the middle of the 19th century. From that time, some Maori and Maori publications began to favour Nutirani and its variants, transliterations of the words New Zealand, and conveniently applying to all the islands that would make up the modern nation-state of New Zealand. The Treaty of Waitangi of 1840 and its 1835 predecessor, a Declaration of the Independence of New Zealand, used these forms. Apart from Tawhiao's bank operating in Waikato in the 1880s and 1890s, few Maori opted for Aotearoa. In the early years of the 20th century, however, with the growing circulation and popularity of Stevenson Percy Smith's version of the Kupe story, Maori use of the term Aotearoa to refer to New Zealand as a whole increased, especially in oral culture. By the 21st century, it was entrenched as the Maori name for New Zealand, though many South Island Maori, favouring Te Waipounamu as the name for their own island, recognised Aotearoa as a name for the North Island only. The conclusion that a historian might draw from the foregoing is that it is highly likely that there was a Maori ancestor called Kupe who sailed to New Zealand from island Polynesia. But he certainly did not travel at the early date specified in the Smith story. It is also unlikely that he was the discoverer of the country, but the number of place names associated with him, particularly in the Hokianga, Mercury Bay and Cook Strait regions, make it probable that he was one of the earliest ancestors of the Maori to leave descendants and therefore memories in those parts of the country. And finally, New Zealand was certainly not known to Maori as Aotearoa in the pre-European times. Just as certainly, it is called that now by most Maori of the modern era. The story of Toi and Fatonga, also compiled by Stevenson Percy Smith, concerns a Tahitian chief and his daughter's husband, who, in the middle of the 12th century AD, became separated at sea by a storm and then set out to look for each other. Toi, the chief, ended up living in Whakatane among the Moriori people who had landed in New Zealand after Kupe's voyage. Fatonga found him there. The eventual settlement of these two men with their entourages in the Bay of Plenty was described by the purveyors of the myth as the first permanent habitation of New Zealand by Maori colonists. An examination of Smith's sources in the 20th century revealed that the story was not derived from Maori traditions. The Toi, who lived in the Bay of Plenty, did so in the 13th to 15th centuries, according to local genealogies. Another Toi from Arawa tradition was contemporaneous with the Arawa canoe. There is no Maori story from any source that tells the Toi Fatonga story in the Smith sequence or which places Toi in the 12th century. After Kupe, however, the second leg of the Great New Zealand myth was the epic journey of the Great Fleet. Here is the school journal version, read and taught over decades to hundreds of thousands of New Zealand children in primary schools and used as a basis for similar stories in a wide range of secondary literature. We shall now tell of the coming of the fleet. About 500 years ago, in the 14th century, a number of vessels set sail from island Polynesia for New Zealand. Their crews wearied by the fierce intertribal wars in which they'd been constantly engaged, and glad to seek a more peaceful home in the fair land of Aotearoa, whose beauties had been so often described by voyagers who had visited it. The canoes in which they migrated, seven in number, were the Horouta, Takitimu, Arawa, Aotea, Tainui, Matatua, and Mamari. Some of the canoes were specially built for the voyage. Giant trees were felled and were shaped and hollowed out by skilled and noted chiefs, with adzes made of greenstone taken from New Zealand by Ngāhoe. All the vessels set out about the same time, the Takitimu being last to leave. After recounting the voyages of the individual canoes and the many setbacks and adventures that befell their crews, the narrative concludes, "Of the further movements of these immigrants it would be tiresome to tell, sufficient to say that they mingled with the Maoris already here and founded the great Maori race that occupied both the North Island and the South Island when the white man came. After the arrival of the fleet, canoe voyages between New Zealand and Polynesia became rare. We have now seen how the islands of New Zealand were discovered and peopled by a race which spread over the islands of the South Seas. trimming their lateen sails to the trade winds, they explored the vast Pacific in primitive outriggers and cumbrous double canoes, probably the most daring and adventurous navigators the world has ever seen. Obeying the call of adventure and following the lure of Hini Moana, the ocean maid, they laid down countless sea roads and boldly faced the tempestuous open sea when few European sailors ventured to lose sight of land. As with earlier stories, this account too had been compiled by Stevenson Percy Smith, supposedly from Maori informants. It was another saga, redolent of derring-do, which Pakeha New Zealanders were quick to embrace and add to the founding mythology of the nation as a whole. Maori, too, would have felt uplifted by the story's themes and accomplishments, and the fact that they were descended from such enterprising and courageous people. Inasmuch as it showed groups of Maori from different places and backgrounds acting together for the common good, the Great Fleet would also become a metaphor for kotahitanga, the fundamental unity of Maori origins and aspirations over and above tribal divisions. So taken were the first two generations of Maori educated to this tale that tribal leaders, Apirana Ngata, Te Puia Herangi, Maharaya Winiata, organised a series of hui in 1950 to celebrate the 600th anniversary of the arrival of the Great Fleet, which by this time had grown to 9 canoes. Alas, and again, as in the case of Kupe's deeds, the Great Fleet story proved to be without verifiable Maori foundations. David Simmons's extensive research of 19th century sources found that the fleet as a concept occurred only rarely in Maori tradition. One Ngāti Kahungunu tradition spoke of 6 trees being cut simultaneously for 5 canoes, and some Tainui and Arawa stories spoke of those canoes setting out together. But the remainder of the canoe traditions were of individual voyages, albeit sometimes linked to a knowledge of others, and Percy Smith had come up with his date of 1350 AD by simply averaging out a great number of unrelated genealogical lines from Matatua, which was said to have arrived 14 generations before 1900, to Aotea, which was calculated to have landed 26 generations before that date. As for the Moriori people, who, according to Smith and his colleague Elston Best, had come to New Zealand between Kupe and the Great Fleet and greeted Toi and Whātonga, the basis for their existence turned out to be even shakier. Moriori, according to, again, the school journal, were a race inferior to the stalwart Maoris and were of Melanesian, not Polynesian, origin. No one knows whence they came nor why they came. They were ocean waifs occupying 3 canoes that had been carried away by a storm from some island to the westward. As time rolled on, they increased in numbers until they occupied many parts of the island. They were slight in build and had dark skins, upstanding or bushy hair, flat noses and upturned nostrils. They had a habit of looking sideways out of the corners of their eyes and were an indolent and chilly folk who afterwards settled the Chatham Isles. In their new home they became peace-loving, timorous and lazy, and as hopelessly isolated as Robinson Crusoe on his island. Precisely who the Moriori of the Chatham Islands were and where they came from is dealt with in the following chapter. Suffice it to say now that almost everything said about them here, that they were Melanesian, that they preceded the ancestors of the Maori, that they were driven off the mainland to the Chatham Islands, that they were timorous and lazy, is demonstrably wrong. But for hundreds of thousands of New Zealand children, the version of Moriori history carried in the school journal and other publications which drew from that source, reinforced over 60-odd years by primary school teachers, was the one that lodged in the national imagination. The great New Zealand myth, synthesized in the early years of the 20th century, was demolished in the last decades of the same century. The principal points of demolition were that the country had been settled far earlier than the 14th century date given for the Great Fleet migration, circa 800 AD, became a consensus among prehistorians in the 1970s, that there had been no Moriori settlement from Melanesia, and that there had been no great fleet in 1350 AD. By the early 21st century, however, the pendulum of scholarly hypothesis was swinging back to a point closer to the Great New Zealand myth. While the bulk of the New Zealand Maori founding population had clearly come from East Polynesia, there was some evidence of early contact with Fiji and West Polynesia. While the Great Fleet concept remained suspect, it became increasingly clear that a significant number of migration canoes had set out from an East Polynesian interaction sphere at about the same time. And that time, while probably not around 1350 AD, may have been within 100 years of that date, and considerably later than the dates which the first professional archaeologists in New Zealand had initially proposed. So the Great New Zealand myth was, if not rehabilitated, at least credited with a renewed degree of plausibility. The story of the Polynesian settlement of New Zealand, assembled with the tools of modern scholarship, however, is more complex than the Percy Smith narratives, more difficult and infinitely more interesting. 4. Landfall. All verifiable evidence from archaeology, genetic analysis, carbon dating, burnt pollen remains, and disposition of volcanic ash showers points to New Zealand having been first settled in the 13th century AD, during the era of widespread Polynesian ocean voyaging. This probability is confirmed by the discovery of Mare Island obsidian on Raoul Island in the Kermadec group, halfway between New Zealand and tropical Polynesia, which can have been left there only in the course of return journeys to one or more Pacific islands. The genetic diversity of Kermadec Kiori is further confirmation that those islands were a staging point for multiple voyages from both directions. Footnote: the suggestion that Kiori were in New Zealand earlier than the 13th century AD, see Chapter 1, is merely evidence of a possible Polynesian landing on the New Zealand coast. Coinciding evidence of settlement is conspicuously absent. Other problems too about the early dates for Kiori bones, such as the fact that they appear to precede even the human settlement of East Polynesia, have yet to be resolved. Returning to the text. It seems most likely that, matching the pattern elsewhere, New Zealand was located during a voyage of discovery and settled as a result of subsequent and deliberate voyages of colonisation by several, possibly many, canoes. Geneticists and demographers have calculated that a population of 100 to 200 founding settlers, including at least 50 women, was needed for the Maori population to reach its estimated size of 100,000 by the 18th century. Analysis of Kiori mitochondrial DNA suggests that there were multiple colonisations by the rat in New Zealand, meaning many introductions, which in turn indicates a number of canoe settlements. The likely sequence of discovery and then settlement is also suggested by elements common to Maori tribal traditions, almost all of which speak of primary discoverers preceding the canoe voyages of organized colonization. The question of whether those named figures were responsible for the discoveries themselves, however, is complicated by the fact that, like Maoris, some of their names appear in island Polynesian traditions in similar roles. Thanks to the well-preserved evidence of material culture, stone adzes, bone fishhooks, and harpoon points, there is no doubt that the major source of Polynesian immigration to New Zealand was the islands of East Polynesia. Precisely which islands may never be known for certain. The distribution of tools and materials uncovered by archaeologists reveals that at the time of the settlement of New Zealand, those islands, the Society, Marquesas, Astral and Cook groups, were part of what anthropologists call a regional interaction sphere, meaning that contact among them was extensive and frequent. It is likely, too, that immigrants heading for New Zealand set out within a short space of time from more than one of those island homes. Such a scenario is confirmed by the fact that New Zealand Kiori display genetic markers that link them to both the Society Islands and the Cooks, though not to the Marquesas. More than one scholar has suggested that pervasive differences between the pronunciation of North and South Island Maori, retained even as successive North Island tribes migrated to the south, may be another indication of different sources of migration from different islands. This diffusionist theory, however, overlooks the possibility of just such variations developing over time and with a degree of isolation within what might have been originally a more homogeneous migrant group. More marked variations in dialect developed on the Chatham Islands after they were settled from New Zealand in the 14th or 15th century. There is a single piece of evidence at variance with the hypothesis that New Zealand was settled from East Polynesia. Part of the DNA record of New Zealand Kiori indicates a link with the rats of Fiji and West Polynesia. This suggests to Lisa Matisu Smith, who undertook the analysis, that rats may have been introduced to New Zealand from a more westerly location before the successful human settlement from central East Polynesia. No evidence of West Polynesian culture has yet been found in the archaeological record, which supports the view that this contact may have been fleeting and not part of the organised settlement of the country. Nominating a date for the initial settlement of New Zealand is rather more problematic. A revision of carbon dates for the earliest New Zealand sites, thus far investigated by archaeologists, reveals none earlier than the 13th century AD. And one such site, at Tairua on the eastern side of the Coromandel Peninsula, dated to the late 13th or early 14th century, also contained the single unequivocally island Polynesian artefact found in New Zealand in an archaeological context, a pearl shell fish lure. Identical lures had been picked up previously from eroded middens in the same coastal region. While the latter have been detached from a datable habitation site, their presence increases the likelihood that the eastern Coromandel was one of the sites of first settlement and that the first people there either came from tropical Polynesia themselves or were closely associated with or descended from those who did. The Kaharoa eruption, which originated from Mount Tarawera and cast ash over 30,000 square kilometres of the North Island, has been reliably dated at 1314 AD, plus or minus 12 years. And the first fossil pollen associated with significant deforestation as a result of fire in the North Island has been found at the same level and just below Kaharoa ash, indicating that the fires occurred just before and at the same time as the eruption. Other fossil pollen remains increase in the 14th and 15th centuries and coincide with the destruction of large areas of forest on the eastern coast of both the North and South Islands, particularly in Hawke's Bay and Canterbury. Given a human presence, and with it a greater likelihood of both accidental fires and fires lit to provide easier access to game such as moa, and given the sharp decline in the numbers of moa and other flightless birds over the same period, it is reasonable to associate these fires with human agents. It is also reasonable to date from these fires the first major human-sponsored modifications of the New Zealand landscape, and with them major modifications to flora and fauna. A 13th century date for the initial settlement of New Zealand is later than those given previously for the beginning of the Maori era of settlement. 800 AD is cited most frequently in the previous literature. But the earlier carbon dates on which this conclusion was based turned out to be verifiably wrong, and a decision to trace such settlement from the 1200s is more soundly based on the range of evidence currently verifiable. It is still an informed guess, however, and there is always a possibility that new evidence will provoke a further twist of the kaleidoscope that will move the settlement pattern towards different configurations. Where in New Zealand were the first landings made? The inevitable absence of concrete archaeological evidence for such an event. Original habitation sites were probably at river mouths or in sand dunes and likely to have eroded or been built over in the era of European colonisation, makes the question impossible to answer confidently. The discovery of the pearl shell lures on the eastern Coromandel establishes a connection with these early colonists, but not necessarily their place of arrival. Maori canoe traditions may have some relevance here, although the purpose of such traditions was to establish connections with specific places, resources, and people, not to recount a disinterested history, and some of them may have referred to internal migrations within New Zealand, not to the journey from a former island home. Descendants of at least four traditional canoe groups, those of Tainui, Matatua, Horota, and Nukuteri, name the Eastern Bay of Plenty as their place of first landfall. And some go further, naming Whangaparaoa on the cusp of the East Cape as the place their ancestors first stepped ashore. And the unplanned arrival at the same part of the coast of one of the late 20th century canoes, accomplishing a repeat voyage from the Society Islands, increases the possibility that ancestors too may have first come ashore there. Other canoe traditions, three, tell of fetching up on the eastern side of North Cape, and two, of the northern Coromandel Peninsula. All are consistent with possibilities allowed by wind and tide, and with modern computer simulations. The fact that at least some of the crops that the colonists brought with them survived the voyage and initial settlement suggests that colonisation from at least some canoes occurred in the warm upper half of the eastern North Island. Clusters of earliest known habitation sites, the northeast of the North Island from Hohora to the Coromandel Peninsula, both sides of Cook Strait, and the southeast of the South Island, provide another basis for speculation. Archaeologists such as Jack Golson and historians such as Belich have suggested that these might represent resource islands, regions where early settlers chose to hunt, garden, and gain access to mineral resources, for as few as three separate canoe groups which arrived in the country at more or less the same time. Such an explanation would solve the problem of how a group of colonists managed to spread so rapidly and, apparently simultaneously, from one end of the country to the other. One could then speculate that, as the early abundant resources of large birds and seals were exhausted, these three groups later joined forces and reproduced, only to divaricate subsequently into the dozens of groupings of the tribal era as populations grew and previously cooperative exploitation of remaining resources became instead increasingly competitive. Against that possibility, closer analysis of artefacts, fishhooks for example, has shown subtle differences in the material culture of the Hohora and Coromandel settlers. The growing consensus among prehistorians is that there are likely to have been considerably more than three foundation groups, that these groups would have explored the whole of the country rapidly to locate its mineral and food resources. In addition to the Auckland Islands in the south, people had visited Jackson Bay in South Westland by the early 14th century, and that they probably arrived within a short time of one another. Discussion of such possibilities will never amount to more than a juggling of hypotheses, but some certainties remain. The first New Zealanders were East Polynesian immigrants. They began organised settlement of the country around 800 years ago. Their descendants were the New Zealand Maori encountered and described by Europeans in the 17th and 18th centuries. And a much larger group of descendants still identifies as Maori, celebrates its identity and nurtures its confidence with Polynesian cultural memories, some of which date back to that time of arrival. For I shall not perish, but as a seed sent forth from Raiatea I shall flourish. In the 13th century, such messages served to prepare a people for a journey of migration. In the 21st century, they fortify the descendants of those same people for the journey of life. Far as it was from tropical Polynesia, New Zealand did not represent the terminus of 5,000 years of Austronesian-Polynesian migration. There were still further journeys to be launched. Mention has been made of a way station on Raoul Island in the Kermadec, established from New Zealand, and of the extraordinarily close similarity of adzes found on Pitcairn Island to those found contemporaneously in New Zealand. There is also evidence that a short-lived Polynesian attempt to settle Norfolk Island may have originated from New Zealand. But the major voyage still to be made after East Polynesians reached New Zealand was on to the Chatham Islands, some 800 kilometres east of the South Island. sometime in the 14th or 15th century, possibly after no more than a century's occupation of the mainland, a group of New Zealand Polynesians transferred themselves by canoe to this cluster of isolated, low-lying islands directly in the path of the Roaring Forties. Here again, analysis of Kiori DNA is helpful. The tightly clustered nature of the genetic data suggests a single settlement of people at one time and provides proof that the source of migration was New Zealand. By the time that New Zealand Maori and the indigenous settlers of the Chathams came into contact with one another again in the early 19th century, thanks to European vessels, neither people had any surviving knowledge of the other, nor of their common origins in East Polynesia and on the New Zealand mainland. As a result of this encounter, the Chatham Islanders began to refer to themselves as Moriori, their dialectical version of the word Maori, from Tangata Maori, ordinary people. The Chatham's culture had by this time diverged from that of Maori in several important respects. The islanders had a level society with no distinction between aristocrats and commoners. They had developed their own version of the Polynesian language. They had no horticulture because the climate would not allow the root vegetables Polynesians carried with them to grow there. And perhaps most significant, they had discarded warfare as a means of settling group disputes and substituted the practice of dual hand-to-hand combat, which would cease as soon as one party drew blood. Their material culture lacked the elaborations of so-called classic Maori culture, in particular intricate carving and a wide range of tools and ornaments, but was, in its pared-down simplicity, adequate to meet the needs of Chatham Islands inhabitants. Of the fact that Moriori were Polynesian and shared ancestry with Maori, there was, or should have been, no doubt. Their language was Polynesian, and despite differences in pronunciation, shared many words with Maori and no other languages. They appeared Polynesian in their stature and features, and their skulls revealed the classic Polynesian rocker jawbone. Not only were their tools of the same East Polynesian style and variation as those of early Maori, but some of those found on Pitt Island would turn out to be made from New Zealand materials, obsidian and argillite. Despite this overwhelming volume and weight of testimony, some late 19th and early 20th century scholars convinced themselves and a gullible New Zealand public that Moriori were not Polynesian. Professor J.H. Scott of the Otago University Medical School reported that skeletal evidence showed that Moriori resulted from an interbreeding of Polynesian and Melanesian antecedents and that the Melanesian element was stronger because the cranial capacity is somewhat less. A group of German scientists published a paper proposing that Moriori most closely resembled the extinct Aboriginal people of Tasmania. John Macmillan Brown, a professor of classics and English and a dabbler in ethnology and history, dismissed the idea that Moriori had any Polynesian ancestry at all. The most coherent statements about the relationship of Moriori to Maori, and as it turned out, the most erroneous, came from the amateur ethnologists who were the founding members of the Polynesian Society, Stevenson Percy Smith and Elsdon Best. Smith proposed in his second volume of The Law of the Whariwananga, 1915, that Moriori were an inferior and dark-skinned people who occupied New Zealand prior to Maori, and that they were subsequently partly absorbed and partly driven out by the more intelligent and more enterprising later comers who had arrived in New Zealand as part of a fleet migration from island Polynesia. Best, in a 1916 article in the Transactions of the New Zealand Institute that revealed collaboration with Smith, filled in further details. He claimed that Moriori were a people much inferior to the Maori in appearance and general culture, with thick projecting lips, bushy frizzy hair, dark skin and flat noses, with upturned nostrils. Their eyes were curiously restless, and they had a habit of glancing sideways without turning their head. this saga, with its lurid allegations of Moriori physical and mental inferiority, was assembled from contaminated and unrelated fragments of so-called Maori tradition. It had no basis in history or ethnology. Yet it was, as noted previously, published in the Department of Education's school journal and distributed to every primary school classroom in the country. This action, supported by subsequent publications which repeated the story, coloured public perception of the Indigenous Chatham Islanders for the next three generations. Condemned by a late 20th century ethnologist as a virulent myth, the construct was a consequence of social Darwinist ideas current at the time of its invention. It explained the plight and demoralization of Moriori in the 19th century as evidence that they were an inferior people, unable to adapt either to the Neolithic world in which they had previously lived or to the modern age of European colonization. If they were, ipso facto, inferior to Maori, who had flourished in their pre-European society and showed signs of being able to negotiate the effects of colonisation, even to assert themselves in the face of it, then the explanation must lie in Melanesian ancestry. This conclusion followed because it was believed that Melanesian skin colouring, the basis for the origin of that designation, hair texture and physical features all indicated a lower order of human evolution than that displayed by the more Aryan-looking Maori. Further, the very notion that Maori had displaced and colonised a more primitive people was both evidence of their superiority and an implicit justification for what Europeans, representatives of a still higher order of civilisation, had done to Maori in turn. In colonising you and your country, we did no more than that which you had already done to Moriori. All the pleasing and convenient resonances of the Moriori myth ensured that it enjoyed a popular currency among Pakeha New Zealanders and among many Maori, long after it had been disproved by the Dunedin ethnologist Henry Skinner in the 1920s. After the virulent myth had been further demolished in more public arenas by a television programme in 1980 and a professionally written history of Moriori published in 1989, another story, equally erroneous and equally innocent of evidential connections, arose phoenix-like from the ashes to take its place in the public mind. This new myth, seized on uncritically by the popular press, generated more reverberations that a new generation of New Zealanders in turn would find comforting. It was yet another variation on the notion that the ancestors of the Maori had not been the discoverers and first inhabitants of New Zealand. This time it was alleged that the honour and distinction of first landfall and footfall had gone to a group known as Waitaha, or more grandly, the nation of Waitaha. The ancestors of these people had allegedly sailed into the Pacific not simply from Asia, but also from Africa and South America. In a kind of cultural version of the geologist's Gondwana scenario, proponents of Waitaha said that the ancestral groups had brought with them concepts and technologies apparent in the earlier human histories of all those continents. The eventual discoverers of New Zealand had sailed there from Easter Island more than 2,000 years before Polynesians arrived. They were a peaceable people, in harmony with the land and the sea. Their secret history, hidden in the trees and in the stones, and withheld from Pakeha scholars for 200 years, would be published in 1995 as Song of Waitaha, The Histories of a Nation. The Waitaha myth presented a range of difficulties for historians and prehistorians. There was not a skerrick of evidence, linguistic, artifactual, genetic. No datable carbon or pollen remains, nothing that the story had any basis in fact, which would make Waitaha the first people on earth to live in a country for several millennia and leave no trace of their occupation. This lack of evidence, the story's proponents would claim, was because Waitaha's stone structures had been mistaken for natural formations or Maori artifacts, and because their history had been kept secret from both Maori and Pakeha scholars. And to confuse the picture further, elements of the story did have a basis in Maori tradition. There had been tribes in both the North and South Islands who used the name Waitaha. In the South Island, some of those genuinely descended from the Maori Waitaha people and the tribes which had subsumed them, Ngāti Māmoe and Ngāi Tahu, embraced with enthusiasm a scenario which made them far more than one Maori tribe among many. A pre-Polynesian civilization which could be said to have prior rights over Maori. Some Maori from other regions who saw similar political and ideological advantage in the Waitaha myth also abandoned their previous and authentic tribal affiliations to become instead descendants of and spokespeople for the nation of Waitaha. For Pakeha supporters, and they outnumbered Maori, the story had multiple appeal. It carried on the popular Victorian notion of cultural diffusion, which held that any cultural innovation displayed by a primitive people, such as the Moai statues on Easter Island, had to have come from a more highly civilized people elsewhere. It incorporated the neo-Darwinist conviction that the representatives of higher civilizations were pale-skinned, as some of the ancestors of Waitaha were said to be. It supported New Age beliefs about the desirability of living in a sacramental relationship with the natural environment, the energies of stones and crystals, and abilities to derive information from cosmic consciousness, ley lines, and the earth's harmonics. And it completely undercut contemporary Maori resource claims against the Crown by arguing that Maori were not in fact descended from the first inhabitants of New Zealand unless they also found and acknowledged Waitaha ancestry. In this last instance, the Waitaha myth became a neat substitution for that of Moriori. Maori did to Waitaha what Pakeha did to Maori. Therefore, Maori have no legal or moral high ground from which to argue for compensation for the effects of colonisation. Not a single scholar, Maori or Pakeha, accepted the validity of the Waitaha nation scenario, and standard histories of New Zealand failed to dignify it even with a mention. But that in no way diminished its popular appeal. Media interest in freakish stories ensured that the public appetite for such stories was sustained. And to the myth of the secretness of Waitaha traditions could be added the allegation that reputable scholars sought to suppress the Waitaha story because it conflicted with paradigms on which their careers and employment depended. And so, for the initiates, the myth of the nation of Waitaha was sustained by a self-reinforcing circle of argument and delusion, of misperception and misrepresentation, that permitted no admission of evidence or common sense from outside the circle. 5. First colonization. The land that the ancestors of the Maori settled was unlike any they had encountered in their remembered island past. To begin with, it was enormous, 1,600 kilometres from the northern tip of Maui's Fish to the base of Aoraki's Canoe, with 18,000 kilometres of coastline. The landscapes ranged from coastal beach and broadleaf coastal forest to estuarine swamps, enormous inland plains, podocarp-covered hills, subalpine ranges, and mountains capped with snow, to which the formerly tropical Polynesians, having never seen such a substance previously, gave the name huka, or foam. There were thermal regions and at least 6 active or soon-to-be-active volcanoes. Compared with the dimensions of Polynesian's basalt islands and coral atolls, the resources of this new country, its minerals, its forests, and the big game food provided by giant birds and seals, would have seemed vast and inexhaustible. Even the days themselves were longer in summer and therefore fuller than in equatorial regions. Second, New Zealand's temperatures and climates varied beyond Polynesian knowledge and expectation, subtropical in the north, temperate in the central region, and cold beyond anything they could have imagined in the south. This factor would influence which of the crops they brought with them could grow and where, and which they would have to discard. Climate would also determine what garments they would need to wear in different parts of the country, what natural materials they would choose to make them, what technical skills they would have to invent in order to make use of such new materials, and what kinds of houses they would need to build for shelter and warmth. It was the adaptation to the new environment of the concepts and practices they brought with them, and the new skills and practices they developed to meet unfamiliar environmental challenges, that transformed East Polynesian island culture into that of New Zealand Maori. And that transformation occurred over at least three identifiable stages, which historians have termed colonial, transitional, and tribal. The Maori colonial era began the moment East Polynesian migrants stepped ashore and continued through the first phase of settlement and adjustment. It is the period formerly referred to as archaic Maori, or, in Roger Duff's famous phrase, the moa hunter period of Maori culture. Duff, fresh from the excitement and revelations of his excavations on the Wairo Bar at the head of the South Island, was right to highlight the role of moa in the economy and material culture of early settlers in that part of the country. But his phrase suggests an overly simplistic understanding of what was happening to early Maori in that era throughout New Zealand. Archaeological investigation of the earliest habitation sites shows that moa were a major source of protein, and in some cases, the major source, for settlers in some parts of the country, especially the east coast of the South Island. Estimates of the number of birds killed, or at least cut up, at the mouth of the Waitaki River range from 29,000 to 90,000, and further south, at the Shag River mouth, at least 6,000 moa were slaughtered over a relatively short period of occupation. Given the size of the largest birds, the enormous amount of meat they carried, drumsticks alone the size of a leg of beef, and the relative ease with which, having no ingrained fear of ground-based predators, they would have been caught in coastal shrubland and on inland plains, the reliance of many colonial Maori on this food source is no surprise. Even the smaller bush moa had a body mass comparable with that of turkeys. The Wairo Bar excavations also revealed that early Maori used moa eggshells the size of rugby balls as water carriers and moa bone for the manufacture of fishhooks, harpoon heads and ornaments. Other factors too were important to the economy, material culture and lifestyle of early Maori, however. The resource islands, which made up what may have been the regions of first settlement, the east coast of the far north and Coromandel Peninsula, Cook Strait, and the southeast coast of the South Island, also provided access to seals, to minerals for tool making, and in all but the southernmost sites, suitable areas for the cultivation of some of the plants the colonists had brought with them: kumara, yam, taro, tea, gourd and paper mulberry, of the 8 possible root crops and 11 tree crops cultivated in tropical Polynesia, only 6 would grow in New Zealand. So moa were a significant source of protein, of bones for ornament and fishhook manufacture, and possibly of feathers for use in cloaks. But other large birds were slaughtered: the flightless goose, an enormous rail now known as the adspill, swans and pelicans, all of them, like the moa, exploited to the point of extinction after little more than 100 years. The fur seal, sea lion and elephant seal were also killed and eaten in such large quantities that after just over a century, their formerly crowded rookeries were deserted everywhere but in Fovo Strait and Fiordland. Other sea mammals, such as dolphin and pilot whales, were also taken by harpooning. And in each resource area, heavy use was made of local minerals for the manufacture of flake knives and adzes, obsidian from Mare Island, basalt from Coromandel, greywacke from the Hauraki Gulf, argillite and serpentine from the NIELSEN region, and chert and silkrete from Otago. Further, the movement of some of these materials, especially Mare Island obsidian, shows that settlers in the 3 or 4 principal regions of early settlement were in communication with one another and either traded or exchanged goods or made minerals available to one another by allowing freedom of movement throughout the country as a whole. While the main emphasis for the first century or so of settlement was on locating resources, hunting, and to a lesser extent, on foraging for shellfish and fish, it is a mistake to portray these early peoples, as some writers have done, solely as hunter-gatherers. The fact that six of the plants they brought from tropical Polynesia survived shows that from the outset, at least in the more northerly settlements, attention was given to planting, nurturing, and harvesting them. They were cultivated throughout the period of Maori colonial settlement so as to be available to play a more important role in post-colonial Maori life, when the big game was gone. Continued gardening, in other words, constituted a dietary insurance policy. The disposition of early settlement sites and their size and character point to an important conclusion. The lifestyle of these people was, if not quite nomadic, certainly mobile. They would occupy a home base, probably the place where gardening and tool-making took place, and a constellation of stations for activities appropriate to certain times of the year, hunting moa or seals, foraging for seafood, collecting minerals. It is probable that whole communities took part in these activities as they moved from place to place, and that there was less specialization than in the later and more stationary tribal era. Louise Fury has described one base settlement in Northland occupied in the early 14th century. In total, 3,200 objects are known from Hauhora. These include adzes, ornaments, fishing gear, bone harpoon points, bone needles, tattoo chisels, bone chisels and awls, and manufacturing tools such as stone drill points, hammer stones, sandstone files and scrapers. These show that there was a full range of activities taking place at Hauhora. The people were engaged in everyday activities to procure food, to manufacture objects in wood, stone and bone, and participating in other activities encompassing the social dimension, for example, competitive sports such as dart throwing or tattooing. Snapper was the dominant food species, followed by seals, but in terms of calorific value, seals exceeded all other species. The moa were probably caught some distance away from the village and brought back as dismembered carcasses. Seals were brought back to the site whole if pups and lighter juveniles, but adults are only represented by bones which were attached to large muscles. Dolphins were hunted using small bone harpoons. The meat was cut up and cooked in an umu, mandibles used to make fish hooks, and teeth drilled and strung as necklaces. The significant lack of vertebrae for the number of fish represented evidence of fish drying in the summer and of storage for later use. There is also evidence of preserving birds. These people in the early 14th century were already following a seasonal round of food procuring, preservation and storage which persisted for hundreds of years. Significantly, skeletal remains from early settlement sites show the inhabitants to have been well-nourished and healthy, even though they seldom lived beyond their late 30s. Historians have speculated that one consequence of this health, itself a result largely of the high-protein diet available to the first generations of settlers, would have been a high rate of fertility. Skeletal remains again reveal that women may have borne as many as 4 or 5 children, and this would have led to a rapid population increase, and therefore to additional pressure on food resources in the first 2 or 3 generations of settlement. As a determinant of culture and lifestyle, the Maori colonial period appears to have lasted between 100 and 150 years. After that relatively short period, the big game was all but exhausted. The northern seal rookeries were deserted, in part because hunters had killed mothers and pups along with adult males. Moa became extinct because of the profligate manner in which this resource too was exploited, a process the Australian ecological historian Tim Flannery would refer to as future eating. With the moa had disappeared a range of other birds, mostly flightless, some of them humanly hunted to extinction, others pursued and killed at the egg, fledgling or adult stage by the rats and dogs which the East Polynesians had brought with them. Most mainland sources of shearwaters and petrels, which nested in burrows, would also have disappeared from a combination of intensive hunting and rat and dog predation. Another factor which accelerated the extinctions was destruction of habitat. Pollen and charcoal cores in swamps reveal that, for whatever reason, a series of major fires occurred in the 14th and 15th centuries, destroying forests, especially in Hawke's Bay and on the east coast of the South Island, but also in inland areas of the North Island and on parts of the Northland and Coromandel peninsulas. The period of the fires coincided with the spectacular decline in the numbers of moa and other large hunted birds. It is possible that fires began as an effort to clear open living spaces and later to drive surviving moa and other ground birds out of their places of hiding. Once started, many fires may have flared out of control. Another theory is that they represent an effort to encourage the growth of bracken fern, which in the Maori tribal era became an important food source. There may be some truth in this, but it is scarcely adequate to explain the full extent of deforestation. The hypothesis that links this with a more desperate and reckless phase of hunting is more plausible. Who were the people of this era? That is a difficult, if not impossible, question to answer historically. Maori whakapapa offer names without remains, that is, stories without evidence, while archaeology offers remains without names, evidence without stories. Maori oral tradition has much to say about the voyages of respective canoes to New Zealand, but little about how people lived in the period of initial settlement. The exception is the large number of stories about ancestors naming geographical features, important markers in tribal tradition that validated occupation and mana whenua, the right of the descendants of discoverers to hold authority over such places. The very absence of other kinds of stories, of how people became established in a strange land, has led to speculation that some canoe traditions may refer to internal migration within New Zealand rather than voyages from island Polynesia. The point of oral tradition, however, was that it recorded what people needed to know to understand and justify present circumstances, not domestic detail about how people lived and worked in an earlier era. In most parts of the country, even knowledge of the moa itself, that considerable contributor to the health and well-being of colonial Maori, had dropped out of remembered tradition by the time of European settlement. With moa gone, there was no reason to recall them down succeeding generations. Roger Duff's description of the boulder bank separating the estuary of the Wairo River from the sea in the north of the South Island is, however, sufficient to conjure up some of the activities of early Maori who lived there. In some ways, these are similar to, and in others different from, their contemporaries in Hauhora. This site was almost certainly a seasonally occupied hunting camp rather than a village home base. The boulder bank would prove the most suitable site for their fishing and fowling economy, and the northern tip of it the obvious spot to settle on. Here the river mouth gave access to the sea for fish and trading expeditions, while along the sea beach accumulated the large quantities of firewood necessary in a treeless spot. The white bait and kahawai ran seasonally into the river and lagoon. Herrings, eels and flounders formed a more permanent population, and banks of edible shellfish thrived at the entrance. In addition, the extinct swan flourished in this favourable estuary, as well as great numbers of duck. Finally, the site was well placed for hunting the large numbers of moas, whose bones are spread today over the 15 to 20 acres of the main occupation site. Perhaps they were rounded up in the Wairo Plain, or driven down from the Vernon Hills, and in either case herded round the base of the Mataora Lagoon, and then driven along the trap of the boulder bank to the cul-de-sac provided by its northern end. Another possibility is that these birds were hunted some distance inland, and brought by canoe or raft down the Wairo River to the campsite. Of the methods of taking the swan and other waterfowl, we may be reasonably sure. Advantage would be taken of the annual molt when the birds were unable to fly and could be rounded up. The first signs of moa hunter occupation occur on the inner slope of the main ridge, which occupies a halfway line between the sea beach and the lagoon. The signs here are most obvious and include a line of pits or ovens surrounded by masses of midden refuse. It would appear to have been the main cooking area of the settlement and situated for convenience some three chains from the main habitation site. This latter hut area carries extensive, though not obtrusive, signs of long-continued occupation. The most important burial area occurred on the outer fringes of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.